Okay, so the biggest reason to quit smoking is the most obvious one, which is it's so bad for your health. Tobacco smoke contains over 7,000 chemicals, including hundreds that are toxic and about 70 that can cause cancer, meaning they're carcinogenic. There are three chemicals that are especially dangerous. That's tar, carbon monoxide, and nicotine. So tar is a substance that becomes sticky in the lungs, and tar itself is actually made up of a bunch of chemicals that are known to be carcinogens. Carbon monoxide is a colorless and odorless gas that binds to the hemoglobin in your red blood cells and therefore allows less oxygen to bind to the hemoglobin in your blood and ultimately results in less oxygen being delivered to your tissues in your body. Nicotine is an addictive chemical that gets into the bloodstream and travels to all parts of the body, including the brain. When someone smokes cigarettes, the nicotine that they inhale gets absorbed by the blood that's in the capillaries in the lungs, and then it gets delivered to different parts of the body when the heart pumps it in the arteries. But what about if someone is not smoking and instead, you'll say, they're chewing tobacco or snuffing? Well, that nicotine gets absorbed mainly through the mucous membranes of the mouth and ultimately still makes its way to the brain, but this is a slower process. But because it's constantly being absorbed, it has a steady state in the bloodstream and therefore has a steady effect on the brain. So it's a more consistent effect of the nicotine on the brain. Either way, whenever nicotine is in your bloodstream and ultimately makes its way to the brain, it activates receptors in the brain's reward and motivation center. This nicotine gives pleasurable feelings, but over time, the brain needs more and more of that nicotine to get more and more of those pleasurable feelings. When the body eventually breaks down the nicotine in your system, you have less and less nicotine in the body, and when that nicotine goes away, that's when the withdrawal symptoms develop, and that's when the cravings develop. So the withdrawal symptoms include difficulty concentrating, nervousness, irritability, anxiety. It can cause sleep problems and cause headaches, dizziness, and increased appetite. Of course, this only makes people want to smoke to get that nicotine in their body. Nicotine comes in different forms, but ultimately all forms of nicotine are not good for your health. Cigarettes are the most popular tobacco products. There's some cigarettes that claim to have less tar and less nicotine, the so-called light cigarettes. But what usually happens is people tend to inhale longer and or smoke more of these light cigarettes in order to maintain that same level of nicotine. Ultimately, they end up spending more money on cigarettes and end up getting the same amount of nicotine in their body regardless. They are just as likely to get a smoking-related disease either way. Now, what about smokeless tobacco? Well, tobacco that is smokeless can still cause cancer and other health problems. So, in other words, chewing tobacco or snuffing is what I'm talking about here. In fact, chewing tobacco increases the risk of oral cancer about 50 times compared to people who don't use chewing tobacco. And there still is a possibility that this chewing tobacco can cause cancer in other parts of the body as well, but this hasn't been 100% proven yet. When it comes to smoking, whether from cigarettes, water pipes, or cigars, tobacco puts you at higher risk for all sorts of diseases. Inhalation of tobacco smoke entails inhaling toxic gases and particles of tar, and eventually it damages the lungs. Not only can it cause damage in the lungs so that people develop inflammation of the airways, meaning bronchitis, but they can also develop different forms of pneumonia in addition to COPD and emphysema. It can also contribute towards other types of lung disease, something we call interstitial lung disease. This includes things like pulmonary fibrosis, where you have scarring of the lungs. It can cause non-infectious types of pneumonia, such as acute eosinophilic pneumonia, in addition to desquamative interstitial lung disease and respiratory bronchiolitis interstitial lung disease. Also, smokers are more likely to get respiratory viruses like the cold, flu, and of course, now COVID-19. Smoking also dramatically raises the risk of having coronary artery disease, including raising the risk of having a heart attack, but also raises the risk of disease affecting blood vessels in other parts of the body, such as blood vessels in the brain, and that's why it raises the risk of stroke. Also raises the risk of peripheral artery disease, where you have constriction of the arteries in the legs, making it painful to walk. It also raises the risk of getting a blood clot in any part of the body. It raises the risk of developing aortic aneurysms, meaning a weakened area of the aorta. And sometimes when people have aortic aneurysms, the aorta can burst open, which causes life-threatening bleeding. When people have this ruptured aorta, they usually don't survive. When it comes to smoking and cancer, it's interesting to note that women are more likely to develop lung cancer compared to men. Now, lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer deaths in women. It actually claims more women's lives than breast cancer, cervical cancer, uterine cancer, and ovarian cancer combined. Also, women who smoke have a harder time getting pregnant compared to those who don't. Women who smoke during pregnancy are more likely to have an underweight baby, which is defined as less than 5.5 pounds. Low birth weight babies are much more likely to die during the first month of life compared to babies who are of normal weight. Also, smoking during pregnancy has been linked to higher rates of miscarriage and stillbirths, and children who are born to mothers who smoke during pregnancy are also more likely to have brain damage, cerebral palsy, and behavior problems. Now, when it comes to the reproductive system in men, smoking is known to contribute towards erectile dysfunction. This happens because smoking slows blood flow to the penis, and if a man quits smoking, he's less likely to have erectile dysfunction compared to men who don't quit. Then there are other health issues that are more likely to arise in smokers. For example, smokers are at greater risk of having stomach ulcers. There's also a higher likelihood of developing visual problems in older adults, such as cataracts and macular degeneration. There's also a higher likelihood of women getting osteoporosis. Okay, reason number two is that smoking affects the way you look. People who smoke are more likely to develop wrinkled skin and have yellow teeth and yellow nails. Number three is that smoking stinks. It gives you this stench that surrounds you and it also gives you bad breath. And number four, smoking affects the health of others around you. So a lot of people want to know, how dangerous is secondhand smoke? Well, in short, inhaling secondhand smoke increases the risk of getting many of the same diseases as smokers do. And this includes lung cancer, coronary artery disease, such as heart attack, and also stroke, and other diseases as well. Secondhand smoke causes over 40,000 deaths in the United States every year. Children of smokers have more ear infections and respiratory illnesses like asthma and bronchitis, and infants exposed to parents who smoke have a greater risk of dying from sudden infant death syndrome. Of course, secondhand smoke isn't as bad as a person smoking themselves, but it's still hazardous nonetheless. Lots of people will do things like blowing smoke in the other direction, or rolling down the car window, or blowing smoke out the house window. And while these are probably better than not doing that when it comes to secondhand smoke, they're still not effective in protecting the people around them from secondhand smoke. Also, air cleaners and other technologies that filter out smoke or cleanse the air, they don't entirely eliminate the secondhand smoke. There's also the issue of third-hand smoke, where dangerous chemicals from the smoke end up settling on clothing and furniture, and that can linger there for months. The thing is that the smoke residue, which stays on the walls and the carpets and other surfaces, they can react with a common indoor air pollutant called nitrous oxide. And when those two react, they can form nitrosamines that persist for months, and these nitrosamines are carcinogens. So this is another reason why it's important for people to quit smoking. It's not just for their own health, but it's also for the health of those around them. Okay, the fifth reason is that smoking costs a lot of money. If you quit smoking, you probably would save a lot of money. And the cheapest cigarettes are in the state of Missouri, with an average price being $5 per pack. So if you're a one pack per day smoker, that's $1,800 per year. And if you live in New York, you're going to double that. So you end up paying $3,600 per year if you're one pack per day smoker in the state of New York. Now, at this point, you probably already know the benefits of quitting, but the sooner you quit, the greater the benefit. It doesn't matter how long or how heavy you smoked, the sooner you quit, the better. We know that former smokers live longer compared to people who continue to smoke. They also have lower rates of lung disease, cancer, stroke, and heart disease. Now, some might wonder, what if I already have a smoking-related illness? Well, no matter what it is, your illness and overall health will be better if you quit smoking. Let me give you an example when it comes to someone having a heart attack. Smokers who stop after a heart attack are less likely to have another heart attack and are less likely to die from heart disease. Also, lots of times, especially as we get older, people need surgery. Someone who doesn't smoke, even if they used to smoke, is better equipped to heal, and they're less likely to have complications related to surgery, or less likely to have complications related to the anesthesia related to the surgery. And another benefit to quitting smoking is the one that I mentioned earlier, which is you'll save a lot of money. So let's talk about what happens when you quit smoking. What happens to your body? So within a day, your body will clear all the carbon monoxide from your system. And when that happens, your blood, specifically your hemoglobin that carries oxygen, it'll carry the oxygen more efficiently and ultimately deliver more oxygen to your tissues in your body in a more efficient manner. Within a week, your breath gets better. Hair, fingers, and teeth, they all get cleaner. You have a better sense of taste and smell. And once you hit that 1 week mark, you're no longer experiencing the worst of the withdrawal symptoms, typically. After about a month of quitting, the cilia in your airways in your lungs begin to recover and remove more mucus from your lungs. So cilia are tiny microscopic hair-like structures that line the airways. You also notice that within a month of quitting smoking, there'll be less sinus congestion, and also there'll be less likely to have fatigue and feeling short of breath. After a year of quitting smoking, your risk of having a heart attack or a stroke becomes reduced. After a few years of quitting, the risk of heart disease is half of that of a smoker. And also after a few years of quitting, the risk of lung cancer decreases. After 10 years of quitting, the risk of lung cancer death is reduced by 50% compared to those who continue to smoke. And after 15 years of quitting, the risk of heart disease is actually the same as non-smokers. Most people know that smoking is bad for their health. That's not exactly breaking news. But why is it so hard for people to quit? What are the obstacles that are preventing them from quitting? Most smokers wish they could just snap their fingers and quit smoking and be done with it already. So let's talk about the obstacles that people need to overcome in order for them to successfully quit. One of the biggest obstacles is withdrawal of nicotine. So nicotine is very addictive, and withdrawing from the chemical causes physical changes to occur in the body, especially in the brain. The withdrawal symptoms typically start within a few hours of the last cigarette, and symptoms include difficulty concentrating, feeling tired, feeling anxious, and being irritable. So this is the biggest hurdle for smokers to overcome, and these symptoms tend to be severe for at least the first 2 to 3 days after quitting. These symptoms then tend to gradually wane over the course of about a month or so. So without question, physical withdrawal is the biggest hurdle. But then there's also the mental withdrawal. This is because smoking is typically a part of someone's daily routine. They're so used to having a cigarette after a meal, or having a cigarette with their coffee, or having a cigarette first thing in the morning. These are all habits, and these habits are typically hard to break. Another obstacle is overcoming emotions. We all have anger, frustration, boredom. Some people handle these emotions in different ways. Lots of people handle these emotions by smoking cigarettes. Often what happens is when someone has emotional distress, that serves as a trigger to light up a cigarette. Another obstacle to overcome is the reality that when someone quits, they'll be expected to gain on average 5, maybe 10 pounds. Why does this happen? Well, nicotine reduces appetite and it revs up the body's metabolism. So when you no longer have nicotine in your system, the opposite happens. Also, when people quit, they often substitute food for cigarettes. So in order to get that mini dopamine rush to feel better. So of course, it's always a great idea to have a daily exercise program, whether someone smokes or not, but it's all the more important to do so and to start a daily exercise program for people who are planning on quitting smoking, because that's going to help them to minimize their weight gain. Also, nicotine withdrawal symptoms in women of childbearing age are worse during the premenstrual phase and during menses. This is why it's probably better for them to quit at the end of their period. A lot of people ask the question, well, if I quit smoking, can I start vaping instead of smoking in order to help me quit? So lots of people are trying to quit smoking cigarettes by turning to e-cigarettes, aka vaping. And vaping entails using a battery-powered device which vaporizes a solution of nicotine that is dissolved in water and propylene glycol. So propylene glycol is a fluid that helps nicotine dissolve. So an e-cigarette gives a person the feeling of smoking, but without getting that tar and without getting that carbon monoxide into their lungs, along with thousands of other substances. But is this a good alternative to cigarettes? It's probably better, but it's still far from ideal. The long-term effects of e-cigarettes are still unknown. Since they are relatively new products, e-cigarettes have not been studied that well, but some studies so far indicate that they can help smokers to quit smoking regular cigarettes without causing harm, at least in the short term. In one study, they were shown to be more or just as effective for quitting smoking compared to nicotine replacement products, but that was just one study, so we're still not sure yet. And smoking e-cigarettes has not been compared to any other medications that are already approved for smoking cessation, such as varenicline, which is Chantix, or bupropion, also known as Wellbutrin. At this time, most experts recommend using these FDA-approved medications for smoking cessation rather than e-cigarettes because their safety and efficacy is well established. If a person does decide to choose e-cigarettes to help them quit smoking the regular cigarettes, it's important that they switch completely to e-cigarettes and stop using their regular cigarettes. This is because using both together is not likely to reduce health risks nearly as much as doing a complete switch. Of course, it's best not to smoke anything or vape anything. A lot of people wonder or ask about vaping lung disease, and that's a whole nother topic. Now, if that's something you want me to cover in more detail, I'd be happy to, so I can make a separate video on that. So let me know in the comments below. And also plan on making a video on the best way to actually quit smoking. So if you're a smoker and you want to quit, you're definitely going to want to check that out.